So we would like to construct the CW chain complex of SUW complex. Let me recall what we did last time. The last lemma is very, very crucial for this construction. So it will be worthwhile to recall that whole thing and also go through the proof very carefully, so that you don't have any doubt left there. So let me begin with this lemma that we did. X is a CW complex, then for each n positive, we have the homology, the kth homology of xn relative to xn minus 1 vanishes for k not equal to n. So it is like now, atomized at one single k, and at k equal to n, it is isomorphic to the free abelian group of rank equal to the number of n cells in X. Okay, this is a consequence of the previous lemma that we have done. I am summing it up here. The second thing and third thing are slightly need some proof, and they follow from this one, of course. So the second thing is hk of xn is 0 if k is bigger than n. That means if you have n-dimensional simplicial complex, CW complex, then all the homology beyond n, n plus 1, n plus 2, etc., they are all 0. The inclusion map, let us denote it by eta n, because it's starting from the n skeleton to the whole of space X, induces isomorphism in homology hk to hk, where k is less than n, and surjection for k equal to n. Okay, let us look at the proofs. Part A is actually a direct consequence of the previous lemma that we have proved, namely, for attaching cells, if you attach n cells to a space Y, then the relative homology, the nth homology, is precisely equal to the free abelian group over the number of cells you have attached, and everywhere else it is 0. You apply that one. It's a special case. Xn is obtained by attaching n cells to Xn minus 1. Okay. So B, let us do it by inductively. For X naught, which is discrete space, hk of X naught is 0 for all k positive. Therefore, we can start the induction, namely on n, this xn. Suppose this is true for xn minus 1, namely for all lower indices, the homologies are 0. That's why we have proved that one. Then we want to prove it for xn. Okay, so inductively assume that the statement B holds for xn minus 1. At k be greater than n, then I want to show that hk of xn is 0, right? In the long homology exact sequence, hk of xn minus 1, this is 0. Hk of xn, xn minus 1, this is also 0 by A. Therefore, the middle term must be 0. That's all. Okay, so B is also proved. Now to prove C, what does C say? This composition from Xn to the whole of space X induces isomorphism for k less than n and surjection for k equal to n. Okay, so this is what we want to prove. First, you assume X is finite dimension, say dimension of X is m. If this n is bigger than m, then the nth skeleton is the whole of X, and the inclusion map is the identity map, and there is nothing to prove. Okay, so you may assume that n is smaller than m, and xn is a proper closed subset of the whole of X. X is now X is equal to xm, because dimension of x is equal to m. Okay, then for each I greater than or equal to 0 and k is less than n, we have the inclusion needs to map n plus I skeleton to n plus I plus 1 skeleton. Okay, the inclusion induced map, these are all isomorphisms from B. Take composition n plus I, n to n plus 1, to n plus 1, to n plus 2, and so on. Okay, you take up to xm, we defeat xm. So all the inclusion maps are isomorphisms. If k is less than n, if k is less than n, k is less than n plus 1 also, n plus 2 also. Okay, you finitely many compositions of isomorphism, they are isomorphisms. Okay, so the composite of finite many is fine. For k equal to n, what happens? Very first one is not an isomorphism. Okay, Xn of Xn to Xn plus 1 here is not an isomorphism, but it's only surjective. After that, all other things are isomorphisms. Therefore, the composite will be also surjective. Okay, so only the first stage is not an isomorphism, but that is actually surjective. So that's what we have to see, because Hn of Xn plus 1 Xn, the nth homology of this one is 0 in the long homology exact sequence. Okay, so that will take care of the finite dimensional case. Okay, now comes the infinite dimensional case. Suppose X is infinite dimensional. Now suppose the inclusion map eta n from Xn to X, where I am taking k to be smaller than n. Okay, suppose this is not injective. We want to show that it's injective. First of all, then we want to show that it is an isomorphism. Suppose it's not injective. Okay, let C be a k-cycle in Xn, which is a boundary in X. That means something here goes to triviality here under the inclusion map. So its boundary is inside X. So C is boundary of Y. Y is a k plus 1 chain in X. But Y is a finite combination of k plus 1 singular simplices. Each of them is compact. So the entire support of the chain, any finite chain, finite after all they are, which is support is a compact subset. Okay, a compact subset of any CW complex is contained in a finite skeleton. Okay, so it's contained in some XM. All right, so what does this mean? This means that this C is boundary of Y, where Y itself is an XM, which means that the inclusion map from Xn to XM itself is not injective, and that contradicts our whatever we have already proved. Okay, therefore Hn of this eta n at kth level, Hk of Xn to Hk of X is injective. Exactly similarly, we can prove the surjectivity also. Okay, using the compactness of any support of any chain and passing on to the finite skeleton here. Okay, now having recalled this one, we can now define the chain modules of chain, and then the chain map also, the boundary operator also. Okay, so let us have some elaborate notations here. For this particular part only, we will have these notations fixed. Okay, so In is Xn to Xn plus 1 inclusion map, but I will denote In the same thing. Instead of going on writing star and so on, In for the inclusion induced map here, inclusion induced homomorphism here. Similar Jn I will write for the inclusion induced homomorphism of Xn into the pair Xn, Xn minus 1. Okay, think of Xn as Xn comma empty set that will be included in xn xn minus. That inclusion gives you a homomorphism at the homology level. So once you have this notation, let us put the nth module or nth group, whatever, just a abelian group it is, of C star CW top X, that is the notation. The CW chain complex of X. It is the homology module of the nth homology module of the relative pair, namely Xn, Xn minus 1. Recall that this is actually a free abelian group over the number of n cells attached to Xn minus 1 to get Xn. It's a free chain complex, it will be finally. So these things are free abelian groups. And the boundary operator Dn, they will be Jn minus 1 composite delta n, where delta n itself is the connecting homomorphism of this pair, homology pair. Remember, for any x, comma a, we have a long exact sequence homology of homology groups, and there are connecting homomorphisms. Hn of xn, comma xn minus 1 to hn minus 1 of xn. So take that nth one and write it as delta n. So that is the connecting homomorphism. And this Jn I have defined already, Jn, Jn minus 1 or Jk, or all of them I have defined here, because they are inclusion-induced homomorphisms. So composite Jn minus 1, composite delta n, okay? This I am taking it as delta n. That's a homomorphism, all right? What we have to verify? We have to verify that Dn composite Tn minus 1 is 0. Once you do that, this will be a chain complex. Okay? So, the following lemma tells you Dn if Dn plus 1 is 0, or you can write it as first Dn plus 1 goes to that one, then Dn, or Dn minus 1 composite Dn, whichever one, for all n, and hence, this becomes a chain complex. Okay? This chain complex will be called cellular chain complex associated to X. So we will just write it as CW of X. Okay, CW of X. The homology of this chain complex will be denoted, will be called cellular homology of X. You can have another notation, H, CW, bracket X, etc. But soon, we will prove that this homology is the same thing as the singular homology of X. And therefore, you will not need an extra notation for this one at all. You can only use this as a description of back to the singular homology itself. Okay? The homology of this chain complex is called cellular homology of X, temporarily. All right? So first let us prove that the composites here are 0. D square is 0 is what we have to show. Okay. So I will show you a commutative diagram here from which all these things will be clear. So this is the diagram. Here, the horizontal arrow, this horizontal sequence, is the homology exact sequence of the pair xn, xn minus 1. Only a part of it I am taken, only four terms I have taken, hn of xn, hn of xn, xn minus 1. This is, remember, this is my definition of cn now, okay? And this is hn minus 1 of xn minus 1, and this is the connecting homomorphism. What is the term here? It is Hn of Xn minus 1. Hn of Xn minus 1, just in the previous lemma, we have shown that is 0. So these four terms are in the horizontal one. There is a vertical one, which is also the homology exact sequence of a pair, namely Xn plus 1 to Xn. So this is delta n plus 1, Hn of Xn, then Hn of Xn plus 1, then hn of the relative thing, hn of the relative thing, n being smaller than the skeleton dimension, is zero. Okay, so these two things you have taken. Even this one is the homology exact sequence of some pair. What is that? Look at hn of this is what is called as the of the triple xn plus 1 xn xn minus 1. Okay, homology exact sequence of the triple, which I have done last time because we needed this one. So hn plus 1 of xn plus 1 xn, and then the dn plus 1 hn of xn 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 minus 1. I can take it as actually, sorry, I can just dn plus 1, I just declare it to be this composition here. Sorry, this is just taken here. There is here one more vertical one. This is again exact sequence of xn minus 1, xn minus 2. Previous term is hn minus 1 of xn minus 1, and this is the inclusion map. What is the term here? It is hn minus 1 of xn minus, sorry, hn minus xn minus 1, hn minus 1 of xn minus 2. Okay, so hn minus 1 being one dimension higher than xn minus 2, that is 0. So this is just that part. Having done that one, dn plus 1, this diagonal arrow, I am just defining it as this composite. That is my definition. This is my cn plus 1. This is cn. This is cn minus 1. And this is dn, dn plus 1. I want to show that this composite is 0. This composite, this map is this composite, this one. This map is this composite, this one. Therefore, if you take dn and dn plus 1 composite, the same thing as starting from here, come down, go to the right and come down. But when you take this composite, this is an exact sequence. So this composite itself is 0. Therefore, this whole thing is 0. Okay, so that proves this lemma. So dn composite dn plus 1 is composite of four of them, and in the middle you get something which is 0, so the whole thing is 0. Now the next thing is to prove that the kernel of this by the image of that is actually isomorphic to hn of x. I want to show that it is isomorphic to hn of x itself. Okay, that is the statement here, right? Hn of Cw of x is Hn of x. What is the definition of on the left hand side? It is kernel of Dn modulo the image of Dn plus 1. Now look at this one. What is Dn? Dn is this composite this. I am taking the kernel of this, but this is an injective mapping. Therefore, the kernel of dn is the same thing as kernel of delta n. The kernel of delta n by the exact sequence is equal to image of jn. Okay? So, therefore, my group on the left-hand side is quotient of image of jn by the image of delta n, dn plus 1. Right? See, this Jn is a subgroup of this injective mapping. To take the subgroup here, Hn of Xn, and apply Jn of that. Okay? And then take the image of that. Do you understand that? Right? So, what is the image of this? Image of this is, image of this composite this. So instead of going under image of Jn there, I can identify that those groups under this one. It is Hn of Xn, the whole of Hn of Xn, modulo image of delta n plus 1. Under Jn, it will be isomorphic to the kernel of delta n modulo image of dn plus 1. So what we have got is the nth homology group here is nothing but Hn of Xn, the whole Hn of Xn, modulo the image of this delta n plus 1. Okay, therefore, it is a co-kernel. Okay, therefore, it is Hn of Xn plus 1. But we have seen that this is isomorphic to Hn of X in the previous lemma. Under the inclusion induced map. Okay. So that completes the proof of this. So under the inclusion induced map only, we get finally this group is isomorphic to Hn of X. Okay. So that is the proof here. So I repeat, kernel of Dn here is kernel of delta n because this is injective. Okay. So that is equal to image of Jn because this is exact. Okay, this is exact. Okay. Therefore, image of, so this is what image of Kn, and that is isomorphic to Hn of Xn because Jn is injective. Therefore, Hn of Cn is equal to kernel of Dn by image of Dn plus 1, which is Hn of Xn divided by image of delta n plus 1. Because Dn plus 1 is Jn composite delta n plus 1. So you can work out this one here itself. This by the image is same thing as a co-kernel here, which is this one. This is surjective mapping here. It's co-kernel of delta n plus 1. Okay, so what we have done a big thing. See, small things we have collected, and finally what we have done is you check out the n minus 1 skeleton to get the n skeleton, whatever is remaining n skeleton. They are only the cells that gives you a free abelian group over the cells, so those things form a chain complex. The homology of that chain complex is the homology of X itself. Okay. So it's very easy to understand the chain modules there. You don't have to work out all the singular homology, all continuous functions and all chains and so on. Okay. So this is quite similar to what we have done for simple shell complexes, the simple shell homology. Okay, in principle it is similar, but we had to work harder here because we are not doing linear things and so on. It is not combinatorial. It is not completely combinatorial. It retains a little bit of combinatorial nature of the simple shell complexes, but it combines a lot of topological information. The most difficult thing is to compute these delta n plus 1s, or dn's, sorry. The new notation is how to compute these dn's. These dn's were very, very easy, and you know, combinatorial data itself gave you in the case of simple shell complexes. Here, it has to be given by the attaching maps. So that is still purely topological. So you may say that catch is there, but even there, it helps, it brings a lot of simplification from the arbitrary singular chain complex of an arbitrary topological space. Okay, so let us take this example now. The homology of the complex projective spaces. We have already given the complex projective space a CW structure consisting of 1-0 cell, 1-2 cell, 1-4 cell, and so on, right? The odd dimension cells are missing there. There are no odd dimension cells there. All right? And in each even dimension, there is exactly one cell. So how does it help? One of the simplest thing is, suppose a CW complex does not have any n simplexes, then its Cn Cw will be identically zero. Therefore, Hk will be also identically zero. Because after HK is the kernel of that homomorphism from that zero module. So sub of zero module zero, quotient will be also zero and so on. So corresponding homologies are all zero there. So immediately you can tell that all the odd dimensional homology of CPN are all zero. Okay. There is more to come. What happens to even dimension? In fact, look at the chain complex. This is CW of CPN. Okay. So how does it look like? The zeroth, there is one cell. So it is Z. There is no one cell. So this is zero. There is a one cell, which is a two-dimensional cell. That's why it is Z and so on. Alternatively, zero and zero. You don't have to know the boundary maps. Boundary maps are automatically zero here because this module is zero. This module is zero, so this map is zero. So they are all zero. Okay. The kernel will be the whole space, the whole module, and the image will be the zero module. So each homology is either Z in the even dimension, or when you go to odd dimension, it is zero. So to sum up, HI of CPN is Z if I equal to 2K and zero otherwise. Very neat result. In order to exploit cellular homology further, we should try to understand the boundary operator homomorphisms that I told you. Okay, so here is a description, a complete description of what you have to do, but I don't have any examples right now for that. My examples were too simple, they're like complex fractal space and so on. But we will have that when you study the length spaces. So let us make a preparation for that. Okay. Let phi alpha from dn sn minus 1 to xn xn minus 1 denote the collection of all characteristic maps of n cells. And restrict it to the boundary, you will get the corresponding attaching maps, f alphas. We know that I am just writing Cn, it is Cn Cw of x. Okay, it is just Cn for me just now. It is Hn of Xn modulo Xn minus 1, right? Relative to Xn minus 1. The freely generated over the basis, this phi alpha. Phi alphas are maps, so they are one chain, one simplexes. So you can think of this one simplexes generating the entire group. A chain will be a linear combination of these things freely, okay, integral combinations of these things. Therefore, in order to determine dn, we have only to find the expression what happens to dn of phi alpha. Dn of phi alpha, by very definition, is an element of hn minus 1 of xn minus 1 xn minus 2. So this is again a free module over what? Over the cells of dimension n minus 1 inside xn minus 1. So let us denote the collection of all characteristic maps of n minus 1 cells by psi betas. Just like phi alphas here, let us denote psi beta. These are for n minus 1 dimension. Observe that the quotient space, when you collapse the n minus 2 skeleton to a single point, then all the attaching maps will be a constant functions when you take the quotient space. Therefore, each cell, n minus 1 cell, when you attach it, will become a sphere. Okay, the entire boundary of the cell, boundary of the dn minus 1 is collapsed to a single point. So what is all these points are common point, one single point. What is that one single point? It is the image of xn minus 2, right? So this will look like the bouquet of sn minus 1 beta. I am writing this one to denote the n minus 1 cells, their images. Sn minus 1 beta is the sphere. So bouquet of this one over beta. So take all this collection disjoint union, take a one point identification. That's the bouquet of sphere, right? So this says, you know, there was an earlier exercise. What is the homology of this one? This homology of this one, of course, H naught is, this is a connected space. So H naught is infinite cyclic. All other homologies are zero except n minus one homology, which is again the free module over this betas, the indexing set beta. And what are generator? Take the Hn of Sn minus one beta, Hn minus one of Hn minus one of Sn minus one beta, that is infinite cyclic. Take generator there. So those will be the generators. You can call them as T beta or minus T beta, whatever. Okay. So the indexing of these spheres is such that the n minus one self psi beta is mapped onto the sphere Sn minus one. Under the quotient map Qn minus one from Xn minus one to Xn minus one modulo Xn minus two. Also, this quotient map induces an isomorphism of Cn. Both of them are free abelian groups over the same indexing set beta. So psi beta is the collection of n minus one cells, n minus one simplexes, a singular simplexes that will go to the generator here of Hn minus one of Sn minus one beta. Beta corresponding to beta. Okay, so that is the understanding. Now you look at the quotient map here, the projection map here, from the bouquet to one of the spheres. That means you are folding all the other spheres to a single point and keeping one of them as identity. Okay, that's the projection map. Okay, this is the projection map onto the beta component. I'm calling them components because this can be actually thought of as a subspace of the product, infinite product of, you know, all these Sn minus one beta over beta. So that I will leave it to you. Okay, so it is beta component is a projection map. Then Dn of phi alpha is anyway a linear combination of this psi betas, which I have written psi betas, right? They are generators here. The bracket psi beta can be thought of as a generator here. So n alpha betas are some integers. Take the sum, which is a finite sum. Though I have written all over beta, most of the n alpha betas will be zero except finitely many. So it looks like this. I don't know what are n alpha betas, but what are they? I can tell you now. If you take delta n of phi alpha, okay, this will be equal to f alpha. The boundary of phi alpha, okay, is given by the attaching map f alpha. Therefore, what is f alpha doing is precisely what you have to understand. It follows that n alpha beta is nothing but the degree of this f alpha starting from Sn minus 1 into Xn minus 1. Then you take the quotient Xn minus 1 modulo Xn minus 2. Then you take phi p beta, the projection to the one single factor. What you will capture is all other components will disappear. Only psi beta will remain along with this integer. And that tells you that that is nothing but the degree of this map. This n alpha beta is the degree of this map. So this will help you in understanding more complicated spaces. It will help you a little bit about the same thing in the case of this singular homology. So we shall do that. Singular homology, what is it? The CW homology of the length spaces. That is our next topic. We shall do it next time. Thank you.